Today we're going to do something a little different from our normal technology videos, and we're going to brew some coffee using the Cona Vacuum Brewer. True to our channel name, I'll shoot a video on a random topic once in a while, and this will be the first. For my daily morning coffee, I use a French press, but for the special occasion, I break out the Cona Vacuum Brewer, which makes an even better coffee in my opinion. This is the Cona D-size vacuum brewer, which can make up to 32 ounces of coffee. My normal tumblers are 16 ounces, so I can get a good 2 mugs out of this. Cona also makes a C-size, which is 24 ounces. Not only does it make a great cup of coffee, it looks fantastic. If you hold a party, curious guests will gather around to watch what appears to be a chemistry lab experiment at the expense of any other activity. People will stop watching the last game of the World Series in the ninth inning to watch this thing work. The Cona vacuum brewer consists of a large glass bowl connected to a siphon tube at the bottom with a rubber seal, and inside the tube is a filter that looks like a little glass rod. I call it a filter because it prevents the coffee grinds from entering the pot. This is the glass pot which will eventually hold the finished coffee. There's a stand that holds all of these components. And finally, a spirit lamp that consists of a snuffer lid, the part that holds the wick, and the glass dish that holds the fuel. To actually get the water to a boil, I won't be using the spirit lamp to do so. You can if you'd like, but it would take a long time to bring it up to temperature. I personally use an electric kettle, but you can boil it in a pot on the stove or microwave the water to boiling temperatures if you want. Since my tumbler is 16 ounces, I'll pour in 2 mugs and start the kettle. In the meantime, it's important to make sure that the glass rod filter isn't stuck to the upper glass bowl before pouring the grinds into it. This can happen when you're air drying the components with the filter in the bowl and you let it sit for too long. Let's consider the coffee. It's recommended that you add 1 scoop or 1 tablespoon of coffee per 4 ounces of water. That would mean 8 scoops for 32 ounces. However, I've found that to be a little too strong for my taste, so I use 7 slightly overfilled scoops. You'll want to make sure that the spirit lamp is filled, because that'll be the main method to maintain the temperature of the heated water. You'll want to use denatured alcohol, which is available at any home improvement store, like the one shown here. Place the wick and the lid back on. I'll spin the stand around to get prepared for pouring the water. Once the water comes to a boil in the kettle, pour it into the glass pot. Make sure that the outside of the pot is completely dry. The temperature difference between the boiling water inside the pot and any water droplets on the outer surface can cause thermal stress in the glass and shatter it. Just something that I've heard, but I'm not going to test that theory. Let's place the pot back into the stand. You'll now want to light the spirit lamp. Let's take off the lid and start up the lighter. The lamp should light up immediately. After a minute or so, the water will start to bubble a bit at the bottom of the pot. Up till now, when you see the components in this position, you may be thinking, how does it work? How does the water get from the pot to the upper bowl and back? It should make more sense when I rearrange the bowl to be on top of the pot, like this, making sure that the siphon tube goes into the water. While holding the pot's handle, I'll gently push the upper bowl while slightly twisting it into the opening of the pot. As you probably noticed, I started my timer as soon as I placed the bowl on the pot. From now until the cooling phase, I'm going to speed up the video to 2x normal speed, but I'll keep the clock at the bottom to give you a sense of the speed of the water flow. You can fast forward through this if you want. The basic principle is that as the water boils, it's forced by temperature and pressure up through the siphon tube, even when the glass rod is in that tube. Once the water has traveled to the top bowl, where the coffee grinds are, you snuff out the flame, which causes a drop in temperature and a negative pressure in the pot. At that point, the water should seep back down through the siphon tube around the tight tolerance of the glass rod and into the pot, leaving the grinds in the top container and resulting in pure coffee in the pot. You'll notice the water slowly seeping into the grinds, making a muddy mixture. Unlike a French press, not all of the water is in contact with the coffee grinds at the same time. With a French press, you're supposed to let it brew for about 4 minutes after pouring all of the water on the grinds. However, I've never run across a recommended number of minutes for a vacuum brewer. Through trial and error, I've found that a medium grind results in a total time of 7 to 8 minutes, where there's at least some water in contact with the coffee. Maybe that's too short or too long, I'm not sure, but it works for me. While we're waiting for this, let's also talk about the level of grind. You'll want to use between a medium and fine grind for your coffee beans. If you grind it too fine, you run the risk of the vacuum not being able to suck the water through the siphon tube because the grinds can clog the filter. If you grind it too coarse, the water pulls through too quickly and you could get a weaker coffee. In this video, I'm using pre-ground coffee that was ground to medium. When I grind the beans myself, I usually set my burr grinder in between medium and fine. Since every component is made of glass, the only contact that the coffee has during the brewing process itself is with the glass, as opposed to other types of brewers which may have some components made of stainless steel. My taste buds aren't as sensitive as others to stainless steel, but I've heard that it can make a difference. So, at the 5-minute mark, all the water that can go up to the bowl is out of the pot. Not only do you see and hear the bubbling of the water in the pot, you can see it at the surface of the mixture in the top bowl. I'm now going to snuff out the flame with the lid. I'll restart the timer to show you how long it takes for the vacuum to pull the water down. Notice that there's a little bit of water that remains in the bottom. That's because there's a clearance between the bottom of the siphon tube and the bottom of the pot. This means that if you make less than the full 32 ounces for this size brewer, you'll end up with a more diluted cup of coffee, because the volume of water that remains in the bottom is always a constant, no matter how many ounces you make. Just something to consider. You can see the coffee in the top bowl travel down to the pot. As I mentioned before, if the glass rod is stuck or dried to the opening of the funnel, you might find that there isn't enough vacuum to pull the water back down into the pot after the brewing's complete. At the 1.5-minute mark, you'll hear the gurgling sound of the water as the vacuum finds itself with no more liquid to pull down. At this point, the water's been in contact with the coffee grinds for a total of a little less than 7 minutes. But as I said before, not all of the water is in contact with the grinds for the full 7 minutes. Unlike a French press where you almost always find some residue of the grinds at the bottom of your cup, there's almost none with the vacuum press. There may be a very small amount of grinds that slip through the funnel, but those end up at the bottom of the pot anyways. Due to the shape of the pot, the few grinds tend to stay in the pot when you pour the coffee. When the bubbling stops, you'll know that the coffee's fully extracted into the pot. While holding the pot's handle, you can now remove the upper bowl by gently twisting it off the pot's mouth and returning it to its place in the stand. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching.